Welcome to Virtual Futures Salon. For those of you who are here for the first time, the Virtual Futures Conference occurred at the University of Warwick during the mid-90s, and to quote its co-founder, it arose at a tipping point in the technologization of first world cultures. Whilst it was most often portrayed as a techno-positivist festival of accelerationism towards a post-human future, the Glastonbury of cyberculture, as The Guardian put it, its actual aim, hidden behind the brush steel, the silicon, the jargon, the designer drugs, the charismatic prophets, and the techno parties, was much more sober and much more urgent. What these conferences did was cast a critical eye over the phenomenal changes in how humans and non-humans engage with emerging scientific theory and technological development. This Salon series completes the conference's aim to bury the 20th century and begin work on the 21st. So, let's begin. Reports of our cyborg future are somewhat greatly exaggerated. At least the kind of reports that emerge as a product of the science fiction fevered dreams that promised a messianic or dystopian human-machine hybrid. Terminator never came to pass. But cyborgs do exist, often less as entities, increasingly as metaphors, and often as narrative constructions. And it is still science fiction that informs us of an aesthetic of the cyborg body. As such, what emerges is a dominant narrative in which assistive devices, such as bionics, are framed, perhaps troublingly, as the sorts of developments which might offer the greatest opportunity for humanity to be extended through extraneous non-biological tools. You see, recent developments in material science, processor speeds, and myoelectrics mean that new prosthetic devices become assemblages of the latest technological developments. And by assuming the future will follow an evolution of the technologies visible in the present, the more techno-utopian among us predicts even more advanced versions of these technologies are to be expected in the near future. But before we take as a given the promises of professional future gazers, let's first acknowledge that there's limits to these devices and question whether we need to stop pointing to prosthetics and more importantly, their users as the early example of an enhanced future human. The subject of tonight's discussion is prosthetic envy, and it describes a condition under which someone might claim to be willing to remove a perfectly healthy limb in order to replace it with a bionic or machinic equivalent. In other words, we're going to explore how the technological potency of these devices is rapidly creating a new relationship between the user of prosthetics and their unenhanced beholders. But let's not forget that we've seen this cultural narrative before. Most notably, when the post-World War America struggled to come to terms with the possibilities offered by the field of cybernetics. Indeed, the 50s exposed a troubled and fractured relationship between the body and the emerging hyper-threading processes of modern connectivity and electronic media. A direct product of this concern was Bernard Wolfe's 1952 story, Limbo. Based 40 years in the future, in the 1990s to be precise, the science fiction novel provides a prototype for a future cyborg civilization filled with men who renounced conflict, cut off their limbs, and replaced them with nuclear-powered prosthesis. Following the events after a recent nuclear war between Russia and America, the narrative outlines how men, and let's be very clear in this science fiction story, it's white men, have decided to literally disarm by voluntarily having their limbs amputated. What emerges is the IMOB ideology. an answer to taming post-war aggressions. After all, amputated limbs can no longer wield weapons, but they can become weapons. Inevitably, tensions arise in this science fictional society between the two sects of the immob, the pro-pros and the anti-pros. So let me explain. Anti-pros are those, having had all of their limbs removed, are lying around with nothing to do. A fundamentalist sect, these men cut it all off and refuse to become cyborgs. In contrast, the pro-pros are those who have replacement of their missing limbs with nuclear-powered prosthesis, or pros, which give them enhanced mobility and the ability to perform athletic feats, not possible in unaltered bodies. Some have even become permanently wedded to their prosthesis by installing biosockets into which the pros are snapped, revealing them to be deeply integrated with the body. So ultimately, what is presented is a society in which social mobility and status is paradoxically translated into physical mobility. Vol amps are men who have undergone voluntary amputation of their limbs. Executives and high flyers, always men, become quadro amps with all four limbs voluntarily removed. Janitors are uni-amps, having only two limbs removed, whilst women and people of color are relegated to the status of limbo or unmodified bodies. So despite the sexist and racist undertones, this novel is painfully prophetic, even outlining a superpower Olympics in which athletes who are vol amps owe their victories as much to those who design their prosthesis as well as their athletic ability. This is not too dissimilar to the cybathlon, which will be occurring in Switzerland in October 2016, which actually sees teams of researchers partner with disabled, that contested word, using various high-tech devices. So limbo presents a present in which technology is a result of our restless, aggressive, and sexual desires. These cyborgs are arguably manifestations of a complicated relationship with technology. So why do I tell you all this? What about today? What sublimates the aggression? Well, today, perhaps design drives desirability. In a Western society where high expectations are placed on individual achievement, it's very easy for some of us to start considering ourselves as always and already disabled. Again, that word. Driving a demand for the body to be rebuilt or redesigned. Indeed, as artificial limbs and assistive devices become actualized and increasingly sophisticated, they have evolved from symbols of loss into desirable design objects. Additionally, some users are opting to have their current artificial limbs upgraded with additional functions such as mobile phone chargers or aesthetic enhancements such as ornate 3D printed covers or LED lights, and I'm sure we're going to hear more about that soon. And some embellishments actually reframe these devices perhaps as fashion statements, which further drives this possibility and perhaps this maybe perverse desire for self-enhancement. So it's time to question our reaction to seeing this result. Is it techno-fetishism par excellence, or is it some sort of post-digital acid reflux? Is the kinesthetic functioning the thing that we find so fascinating about prosthesis? Technologies in the image and likeness of us, for want of other words. Is this wonder reminiscent of the same wonder for the automaton? Amazement at a prosthetic arm that moves like a real arm? Or perhaps it isn't a machine's ability to mimic the organic limb at all. Perhaps that isn't what captivates us. Instead, it might be the prosthetic promise that soon these tools might be hardwired into the human nervous system, creating integrated cybernetic circuits. Perhaps this envy is actually driven by a desire to be wired in, just in the same way as American soldiers are wired into intelligent cockpits or computerized guidance systems. Neocortical warfare, inevitably reframed as consumer technology, promising a deeper mind-to-machine relationship. Well, I know at least one of these panelists has a particular problem with at least this future. Either way, we must still approach this subject matter with skepticism. Prosthetic limb users note that current devices are still inconvenient. The current interfaces between device and the human body sometimes cause pain or abrasions on the skin, and the prosthetic is prone to break. But this panel isn't about just the subject sitting here tonight. It's about our collective relationship we have with the objects of discussion, prosthesis. So we all have some questions to ask. What does it mean to have machinery incorporated into the body? How does upgrade culture operate on the body? Where does the techno-fetishism for prosthetic devices originate? What might drive an individual to have their limbs removed or replaced with bionic equivalents? And I almost see some of you already shaking your heads in disgust, perhaps. And so, to answer some of these questions, or perhaps none of these, are our esteemed panel. And I want to kick off with Nigel Ackland. And Nigel is my license to be able to give that sort of opening remark. Because Nigel, you are a provocateur. A very particular provocateur, and I've been blessed to know Nigel for the last 2 years as he's shared his own personal story with many individuals. And I wonder if you could share some of that story with any folks in the audience who don't know that.
Basic rehash of how I got in.
Yeah. Basic rehash.
Yeah, I had a work accident. So nothing heroic, nothing special. I got caught in a huge industrial blender. My arm was crushed. I went through 6 months of surgery and infection before speaking with a surgeon and deciding that amputation would be the best route to go to. I knew bionic arms existed, and I'd been told that my company's insurance would pay for my healthcare. It wasn't the case, unfortunately. And basically, over the next few years, I went through perhaps 10 or 12 operations, several hospitals, several doctors, until eventually I had two amputations and finished up with a heart attack. In 2011, I got to be, I think, the first tester in the world of the bionic V3, and my life has totally changed from what I was, due, I guess, to the technology and the interest in the technology. So now I spend my time trying to make people aware of what's out there, because everyone I speak to will know an amputee, either directly or indirectly. So I try to spread awareness of this technology and hope that the groundswell will persuade governments worldwide to make these type of prosthetics more available to people if they choose to use them. And the emphasis is on the word choice, because when you become an amputee, you lose your choice. Don't ever think you're going to get one of these. You're going to get a hook controlled by a bit of string and a rubber band. This isn't on the NHS menu. So. But I spend time now talking to people and trying to encourage other people to get a decent life, trying to raise awareness, raise funds, doing what I do because I think it's the right thing to do. And that's me.
And one of the things that we've spoken about before, Nigel, on other panels is specifically, you're often framed at very techno-progressive events. You're placed on stage with events with titles like Human 2.0 or Enhanced Human. Yeah. And I know you have very specific views around that sort of framing.
Yeah, I mean, compared to the guy I was when I lost my arm, I'm not enhanced, I'm not a cyborg. This arm isn't as strong as the one I used to have. It's not as dexterous as the one I used to have. If I want to go swimming, this comes off, I go around in circles. You know, it's as simple as that. Compared to what I was 2 years ago as an amputee dying in a hospital bed, yeah, I am probably a cyborg and the technology is made up for that. But I do have a problem with a lot of the terms we use, particularly with the disabled word. So I think we put labels on people far too readily and we define them by what we think they are. I'm not a cyborg. in my head, I'm a human being. I've just got a really cool arm. And that's it, you know. Carry on.
So it's interesting what you say about this choice to have a limb or not to have a prosthetic or not to have a prosthetic. And I know, Catherine, you've made the choice not to. And there's very specific reasons for that, isn't there?
I think I wouldn't call it a choice. I think it's a lack of choice. I, unlike Nigel, was born without a left hand. And I, well, like you said, it's a hook on a, it's ridiculous. The things that are on offer through the NHS are useless. They were useless for me. So by the time I'd reached an age where I was interested in prosthetics, I'd already learned how to do things in my own way anyway. So actually having something on the end of my arm just sort of got in the way. So I wouldn't say I've chosen not to use prosthetics. If they were useful enough, maybe I would consider it, but it's a lack of choice rather than a choice, I think.
But that recent interest, where did that emerge from?
So I've been working with a company called Open Bionics, which are developing 3D printed, more affordable prosthetics. And my relationship kind of came about with them through, they were holding a focus group for amputees or congenital difference. And I was just intrigued to see how far the technology had come. I hadn't really been keeping an eye on it that much, and I just sort of went along. So they were interested in what we wanted, how we wanted them to function, how we wanted them to look. And it was actually far better than I thought it would be. And so I suppose in a way my opinion of prosthetics has definitely changed, and I am considering it, but I mean, for me it's the functionality of it, and I don't know yet if that's useful to me right now.
Because you spent your time developing your own way of being with your difference, is that right?
Yeah. So until I can put on a prosthetic and do things comfortably, it's really just going to be in the way, I imagine. I mean, I can do everything anyone can do. So really, I guess it's what it can add to me if it is helpful or useful. I think I have a very complicated relationship with prosthetics because I grew up without one. So until it reaches a stage where they are useful in some way or another, whether it be functional or emotional, I don't know. But yeah.
And I know we're returning, because we had a wonderful conversation on the phone earlier, and I know we're returning to some of those things that you were talking about, what functionality it might be. But Nikki, I want to turn to you. You were given the bionic small. Firstly, I wonder if you could explain your story and a little bit about the limb for people who haven't come in contact with you before.
Yeah, sure. So the same as Catherine, I was born without my right hand. I tried a few prosthetics as a child. I tried the hook that Nigel mentioned, other forms of rudimentary prosthetic, and I never really got on with it. I always found them too heavy, couldn't really do the things I wanted to do. It was much easier just to do stuff with one hand. It was only just over a year ago that I was approached in the street and offered a new hand that someone was developing, which sounded like kind of like a far-fetched dream. Didn't really think twice about it, just took their business card, got in touch, and then was really surprised when somebody called me and said, actually, we're developing this hand, it's called the bionic. Would you be interested in trialing it for us? And I said yes, because I thought, well, why not? Since I've had it, I guess I went through a bit of a period where it was quite frustrating to use it, because I was so used to doing everything with one hand. And there was definitely a learning curve where I had to say, hang on, you know that you can do this faster if you do it with one hand, but try and do it with two, because you don't know what opportunities that might lead to. So I did that, and I now found that, yes, there are times I still want to throw it away, but actually, it gives me more opportunities in life, because not only can I do a few things in different ways now, you know, I've got two ways of doing everything, it also, I think, leads to opportunities for me in further life where this hand might not last that, you know, as long as it should do because it's doing the work of two hands. If I have this one as well, then I can spread that work out. I'm less likely to get arthritis in this hand or something like that. And I just have more choices because the technology will probably get better. And if I'm lucky enough to be part of that evolution as well and try out the new technology, there could be exciting things in the future.
So one thing I would like to discuss with you specifically is this, there's so many contested terms that come with a discussion of prosthesis, and one of those is enhanced. Now, I know your American counterpart, Angel, who shares a similar, and I think it's the same, bionic small, says that she is enhanced. And she's very proud of that statement. Do you feel enhanced?
No. I feel different. This is me with my robot hand on, and then sometimes I'm me without it on. It's not enhanced necessarily, it's just adapting.
And that's exactly some of the things that I would like to coax in this panel. It's that issue of difference. How are we framing these discussions? And James, I want to turn to you because I know in the last week you've been the receiver of a lot of prosthetic envy. And it was documented very well by the BBC. And we saw firsthand people coming up to you going, oh my God, man, that's so cool. How do I get one? And firstly, before we even talk about that issue, could you tell us your story for anybody in the audience who doesn't know it?
Yeah, I fell under a train 4 years ago. Kind of led to the loss of the limbs, and I was just kind of going along. I did kind of the minimum required in terms of rehab, so I got the leg going because I felt like walking's kind of key, and like these guys get along with one hand. You can do pretty much everything. You can do anything with one hand. So I wasn't really focusing on it, but when I was in my prosthetics clinic one time, I saw a poster on the wall that was Victoria Modesta wearing a stereo leg created by the Alternative Limb Project. And that was a weird kind of strange point where I kind of had this focus on this weird desirable object, thinking that she'd customized this part. Like she has the ability to work with an artist and create an amazing representation of her interests or her personality. And I checked on the website regularly. It was a really crap website to begin with, so there was nothing there. But about 2 years in, I was seeing some really cool stuff, but the best thing was that there was a form on the website that was asking for amputee video gamers to submit their details and their ideas for their limbs, which was just crazy. It just seems like a really strange thing to want to find an amputee video gamer. So I just filled it in like ASAP to try to get it in just in case it disappeared. It's just weird seeing something on the internet that you might actually win and it's not just lies. I was contacted a few months later and we began creating this unique prosthesis. It was kind of supposed to be a bit of a technological, like a condensed amount of technological gadgets. It wasn't supposed to even be functional at the start because like you guys, I was getting along with one hand. And the issue for me is that I have a high level amputation, so I don't even have like an elbow or a forearm to manipulate objects with as easily. So I was thinking, why don't we just create something that gives me more function? So different function. It can't match a human arm right now, so why don't I just wear something better? So I'll put my phone in it, I'll put my money in it, I'll have a free pocket for more stuff. So it kind of ended up being a bit of a weird whirlwind of an adventure whereby we created something. And kind of a lot of the gadgetry, unfortunately, got missed out. We're supposed to have Google Maps and stuff in it, but we spent so much time and budget on the design because I brought like 430 images to inspire the design, and they were like, you need to just condense your ideas because I just wanted everything, unfortunately, because I just love technology and science fiction. But yeah, we've ended up with this awesome limb that came out in February this year. And I've been going everywhere with it and traveling around the world pretty much. There's a massive interest in it. People just, their curiosity is absolutely spiked. The weird thing is that unfortunately, there's a bit of a mismatch again between reality and and their expectations, especially due to the kind of the immersion of scientific concepts developed in movies currently. So people just come up to me and say, "You're the Winter Soldier. You're Bucky. You're whatever Eric, some guy from I don't know Full Metal Alchemist. I just don't know any of it, but." they think it's going to work like a human arm because it looks so cool, but the thing is that it just looks cool. That's what we did here.
So how do you again? You're new to it, and I saw it firsthand at Body Hacking Conference. So people coming up to you going, "I want one. How do I get one?" And you're sitting there going, "Well, you got to cut one off first." You know, it kind of works that way around. You know, it's going to cost you an arm or a leg to get into this club.
And my main annoyance with that is, why don't you just wear like a t-shirt that's a bit different first? Like they're just wearing normal clothes and they want a bionic arm. Why aren't you wearing like a Google glasses at least? Like try something to enhance yourself. That doesn't mean you need to chop it off, right?
But are these things being framed, and I'm gonna go back to Nigel perhaps, are they being framed in the same way as things like Google Glass? People looking at these things as, oh wow, okay, this is a consumer piece of tech that I potentially could have.
To specific audiences, yeah. I mean, there are people that are getting so carried away with it, they do think it's the be all and end all. And it really isn't. It's great, but try scratching your bum with your eye shut. It's not a good move. You know, it's all sorts of stuff can happen that you don't want to, you know. It's not the be all and end all. They are excited. I mean, I get it so many times. Oh, can you do everything a human hand can do? Well, no, I can't. I can't feel my wife's face. I can't play the piano like I used to. Saxophone's out of the question. So it's not as good as people think it is. They are caught up in the hype. They see Terminator and they see the CGI stuff and they think it's the norm, especially carbon fiber. I mean, the Paralympics straight after that. I got asked so many times, was I in the Paralympics? Because I wore carbon fibre. I'm nearly 60, for God's sake. I swim in circles. What am I going to do? You know? But it's something that we pick up from media, the TV, the movies, and for some reason, the logic just is bypassed, and we go, oh, that's real. And we're not there yet, by a long, long stretch of the imagination.
Catherine, this is something that we discussed on the phone. You see individuals with the same difference as yourself who are receiving this attention and media because of what is additional to them. Is that a drive? Is that something where you're like, that's odd, or why is that happening perhaps?
I'm not sure. I think I feel two ways about that, because for a long time I think disability was ignored by the media. And it kind of, I think in the last sort of 5 or 10 years or so, there's been a lot more coverage, particularly things like the Paralympics. You've got all sorts of celebrities now with different abilities, from models, comedians, actors. And actually, I feel that's a very, well, it is a very positive thing, because when I was growing up, I didn't have anyone to kind of buyer to be like that was in the media, so it's that side of things is much more positive. But I can see how the hype is misleading people, and how it could drive certain individuals to want to cut off their limbs, which is ludicrous. But
that's a provocation.
Yeah.
That's a provocation based on the extreme examples we were seeing at places like Body Hacking.
I think it's a weird battle of clickbait as well. There's a weird blame to put on the media, because they just, every time they see any advancement in prosthetics, they want to sell it. Like, they want to make sure people are going to click on their link, so they just say, brain-controlled prosthetic. When it's whatever, they've not read
that
it.
Guy,
it's not
that
even
guy over there is from Vice, and there's that guy from the BBC.
Yeah.
And that
one's from, I mean, Wyatt, best of luck. Like, just try and make it real. Just don't lie.
But is there a weird balance between that media attention? Because I know there was a massive amount of media attention when you first was gifted the bionic small, and that's faded away now, but you don't caught it, am I right? It's purely...
No, it just comes to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what's your reaction to that? What's your...
To be honest, I'm happy to do it because I think it's interesting, and if I get the opportunity to, like I am today, actually talk about the realistic, you know, the reality of having this hand, mm-hmm. then all the better for it, because then people see a real picture of what it's like. I think the thing that I've found fascinating since I've had the hand is not only that people find me more approachable, so they prefer to talk to me as a person wearing this than they would do if I wasn't wearing it, which I could easily be doing.
It makes people comfortable to think that you're trying to be like fit into the mold of their reality.
And then further to that, I actually find that I get more benefits for being disabled. So, you know, I'll go to a museum and I'll get the reduced price access. I'll go swimming and I get in for free. They never noticed before. They didn't care.
Well, Nigel gets in for free, but he's just there in circles. So. Trying to fish him out. But do you find that these symbols are almost being worn as symbols for you? It's just part of your everyday being. It feels so stupid we're almost having this conversation. I almost destroyed BF Salon before it's even started, but it feels odd that this conversation even has to occur. It's just a different way of being.
Yeah. I don't know. What's the question?
So, all right. So to be fair to you, coaxing the phone call conversation we had, but I mean, I came across you because of your arts practice, and this difference was never foregrounded. And it's interesting that you choose not to make that part of your identity, part of your practice. And I'm not saying that Nigel is, but that's how you're framed now by media or press or externalized. It's the gentleman with a prosthesis, and you have a wonderful way of dealing with it, for which we're going to come back to. And same with James. Do you think these devices are becoming normalized? Do you think disability, full stop, and it's a contested word, and we should talk about this word, is becoming normalized?
I would love to see the day when you walk down the street and somebody says, oh, look, there's someone with a bionic arm. And they go, yeah, this little kitty over there's got one. And that lady over there's got one. And that bloke's got two. What's the biggie? That's the day I'm looking forward to. But that's only if people choose to use them. And like Catherine says, you know, you spend so long. In the UK, the average age for a child who's either born limbless or loses a limb, the average age for a child in England to be fitted or tested to use a myoelectric of any sort is around about 9.5 years old. In Sweden, it's 3.5. That's the difference. It's more acceptable because you're using it from day one. We're not. And Catherine's learned to live all her life and you know, doing everything you do. And you're right, it's an encumbrance. I hated wearing a harness and a hook. And the difference is, like you say, you get people come and speak to you. When I had my hook on and I'm standing outside a shop and a 70-year-old lady comes up, tugs you on the sleeve and says, are you all right, dear? Are you lost? Do you need help? It's beyond the joke. You know, people don't say that now because they see this and they see some mad technological thing that they've only ever read about in science fiction. I can't be disabled because I'm controlling it.
But then it's remarkable how many people offer me their seat on the tube because they see this.
I've never been offered a seat on the tube.
I never was. I never was until I got this. So people see this as a sign of perhaps a larger disability than I actually have.
Do people offer you a seat on the tube or do they just run?
Maybe it's the gender thing.
Stay away from them.
Or maybe it was just that lunch I had.
but in seriousness, Jim, the story through which you created that arm, it's got its own name, Aladdin Industries. If you could explain that to us and why that was so important with the creation of the limb. So I think there's something interesting that where you've been so part of the design and the rendering of this arm, the bionics are pre-existing products out in the world. And I think there must be something in that creative process that makes that feel more like you, or perhaps is the struggle of wearing it makes it less part of you?
I don't know, because this is the first one I've made. I've not worn a bionic, so I guess I don't have a comparison. I only have a comparison with an NHS hook. So it's really hard to compare them, but I've noticed the impact that it has on a certain bionic user, Angel. She was absolutely not fussed about my arm at all because she sees it as 3D printed. She sees it as weak, it's like weaker, it's not as strong as the commercial hands. But I met her, she saw it, and she was like, I need to tell my prosthetist, I need lights. I need gadgets, I need to cut slices in it, I need to... And she was just popping in Bluetooth speakers, just chucking stuff in her socket, because she just suddenly realized, like, this isn't me, this is just off the shelf. Like, I want to make it me. So that's partly what I've kind of hopefully put a couple of seeds in the ground with this project by designing it and creating a backstory. Like you say, it has its own kind of fictional creation. There's a company behind it. There's a website, allodyne.com, and it has information about like their activities. So I kind of wanted to create a little story for the arm, the same way that I have parents and I have a life story. It kind of comes out of somewhere. I guess, essentially, yours does have a story too, because it's RSL Stupa has invested millions of pounds in creating robotic hands. So I just needed one for my unique arm, I think.
And it's that piece that makes it unique. I know, Nigel, back to the conversation we were just having, you are dealing with individuals who ask for a selfie in a very interesting way now. Specifically,
the middle finger selfie. Or?
Well, it wasn't the middle finger selfie. You were telling me something very specific about you remove.
I tend to sort of just ultimate selfie, take it yourself, and I had to stop for a while. Some guy got really freaked out because of the noise it made, and when he explained to me that I was actually freaking him out, then I realised the effect that prosthetics were having on people, because you know when you walk down the street and you get people avoiding you. Because you're wearing a hook. You don't actually think it's the hook. Because I didn't. I just thought people were being tossers, you know, and ignorant. But then when I started wearing this and I saw the difference this had, I realized that it was actually the prosthetic. Because I'm a reflection of your mortality. This could be you. And if you see someone like me walking down the street, it's a pretty harsh reminder of just how easily your body can be messed up. And you don't want to deal with it. So you turn away. The barriers come up. And this breaks down those barriers. People do want to know about this. I had a guy on the tube say to me, I'm so glad I've seen that because I know now that if ever I lost my arm, I'd get one of those and life wouldn't be so bad.
It's not that bad.
Well, that's what he said. That's his thing. But that was how he perceived it. Something like this would make his life okay if he lost an arm.
So where is that educational miseducation coming from?
I think movies.
It's just a lack of, it's a lack of interest in the field. I feel personally I've interest in it, Nigel has interest in it. It's like maybe they know about the next Galaxy phone or the next iPhone, but there's no useful application for a prosthetic arm if you don't have an arm missing, so why would they know about it? That's just the problem of the situation of the nature of being an amputee. There's no like comparison that they can have, unless they break their arm or something. I don't know.
But there's a difference of attention. You're receiving a lot of new attention because of bringing this, and you don't always bring it out in public. But when you do, you receive plenty of attention. People walking down the street asking for selfies, you received a certain amount of media attention because of the Be Bionic. You do or don't receive certain amounts of attention because of the choices that you've made. And the thing I was referring to around, not to speak for you guys, but the thing I was referring to around the selfie is that you just take the arm off, hand it to the other person and go, is it a selfie with me you want? Or is it a selfie with the arm?
Yeah, it's normally, I just take the hand off. I don't often take my arm off. I'm one of those that's really kind of self-conscious about my stump. I don't even like catching my reflection in the mirror at 3 o'clock in the morning when I get up to the loo. It freaks me out. So I tend to wear a prosthetic all the time. I mean, this goes on 5 minutes after I get up and it will come off just before I go to bed. I just chuck it on the floor and plug it in and that's it, I go to bed. So I use this all the time. The hand I'll take off because the way I see it, it is about the hand. I'm not there to promote me. It's just about that. You want a selfie with a hand, have the hand and do that and talk about the hand. I'm just the old fart that carries it about.
And in the contrast, Catherine, you don't have motherboard and wired phoning you up going, can we take photos with you, with your thing, your object, your tool, your piece of technology? But that's okay, yes, or?
I think so. I mean, I don't really have too much of an opinion on it, I guess. I feel that really it is a positive thing. I think if I'd have grown up with this sort of coverage in the media, I would have maybe felt a lot more comfortable, but I didn't see that in the media, so I'm not against it in any way, I think. I get that there's certain individuals covered more widely than others, maybe, but that's just being in the right place at the right time. That's like any sort of media situation, I think.
And do you guys feel like you can lead any of the discussion around these contested terms, whether it's enhancement or disability, because of the attention that you're receiving? Or do you even have any interest in engaging with it? That's the other question.
I think just getting the opportunity to say something is an opportunity to lead the discussion. There will be plenty of other people who won't have that opportunity, and I can't say that I can speak on their behalf because I don't know how they think, but I know how I think and I know I have something to say, so when I get the opportunity, I say it. But if, you know, if I'd never been approached and never been gifted this hand, it's not like I would have ever gone looking for it. It's just something that came my way, and so I decided to see what I could do with it.
And James, the same question around this issue of attention. You're James Young, that's how I know you, but you're also, to so many people, this 6-foot-tall, 7-foot cyborg. You know, and how, but then how do you deal with that? I wish I had one, and, you know.
I don't know. What I like about this, which I kind of said in the documentary, is like, I call it a terrible adventure because with this arm at least, it's definitely nice to just have a positive reaction. Like we've said, like people are just so much more positive, even though they don't know that I don't have an elbow that I can move myself, or a wrist, I just have to move it with my other arm. It's just the hand I can control, so it's kind of like, it's not really a great deal of use, but essentially people love it, and they're really curious about it, so I kind of like the invitation that I'm giving to spark and just receive their curiosity. It's just really awesome. I feel like I've been put in the situation where I can, especially at this time, whereby there wasn't like a full limb that was created, a custom full limb just yet. I think this is probably the first one that's the full custom arm. It's kind of put me in a position as a person to go and speak about this kind of stuff, which is just, it's just timing. Like Nigel says, if there was every guy on the street with one, then I'd be just every guy. I'd be struggling to get along, probably. Just, yeah, I don't know, unless I'm actually just really a good public speaker. But I don't know.
Which you are.
No. But what was I going to? I was going to say.
Yes, you are.
I was going to say something good then, but I forgot. I'm not making the case for it, am I?
So let's go back to these contested terms. I was coaxing. I was playing in the opening statement. But
yeah, go for it.
I would leave it for the psychologists and the clever people who figure all that out. Personally, I'm just engaging in scientific curiosity because even before I had my accident, I was interested in cybernetics. I went to explore Reading University and met Kevin Warwick, the first cyborg. I was almost going to study it. So for me, it's a terrible, terrible adventure because I've been put in a position where I've got a full arm missing, which is like the arm is the least developed piece of, bionics equipment, essentially, and the least integrated. So I'm just in this terrible position, which is actually quite fun for me because I find it interesting before my accident. That was it. Thanks, sorry.
So those contested terms that I wanna play with, and I feel comfortable to do that because of this gentleman, 2 years of throwing these terms around, but is it prosthetic pilot? Is it prosthetic pioneer? Is it disabled? Is it enabled? What's the correct terminology? Is it just different? Should we just accept it as difference and then we'll move on, close the panel, go to the bar? Like, how do we do that? Because language is the key issue, which is causing the framing.
Labeling is what we use to transfer ideas, so it's kind of essential that we need to pin it down. But it's a weird one because I myself, even like with a leg, I feel like the leg, I don't know, it counts as what I need, but I don't feel like a disabled person in any regard. Like if I want to do something, I could probably do it. It might take me quite a long time to figure out how to do it, but I could do it. Even just with half like a tiny little bit of bone and a crappy arm that's buggered, but I can still do it. It's just, and then people go, no, but you're obviously disabled because you don't have an arm. It's like, not really disabled. Like I don't have anything wrong. I can still function. It's just like takes longer or it's just slightly more difficult, but still I can achieve. So it's really confusing to be called disabled. And I don't even connect to it. I'd like, sometimes like you say, Nigel, in the mirror, I see myself and I go, oh, fuck, like missed an arm and a leg. Like, I don't see myself in that way. Do you?
No, I mean, when I look in the mirror, I'm not worrying about the fact I don't have a right hand. I'm thinking about the ice cream I ate yesterday and my hips, you know. Yeah. I'm not, I often, when I see myself on film, I'm the one that goes, oh shit, she's got one hand. whereas, you know, everyone around me is much more used to seeing it.
So weird, isn't it? Self-perception.
Yeah.
In those terms for you, Catherine, is there some that are useful, some that should be rejected? Like,
I really don't know. I still haven't found that particular term that I would feel comfortable using. I think it's definitely different. Like, obviously, disability is a very broad thing. So perhaps some people feel comfortable describing themselves as that. Or, I mean, the thing for me most recently is limb difference. And that is the only word so far that I've found that I could describe myself as, which is interesting because I think when I was talking to you, you said that everybody has a limb difference. Everyone's got more spots or more hairs on their arm or something. And I was like, oh, damn, you like ruined my word that I was using. And I just, I don't think we're ever gonna come to a kind of conclusion with this. I think it's just being aware of how people want to talk about themselves or if you do use the wrong word, the people will correct you. It's not, I don't know, maybe I'm less easily offended than some, I'm not sure, but if somebody was to describe me as disabled, I wouldn't take immediate offence to it. Like, it's never a word I've used to describe myself, but I wouldn't feel unhappy if that was what's a term somebody wanted to use. It's just, I think it's a very personal thing, I think.
Same for you, Nigel. I know you played around with terms. I think at one point it was the pioneering pilot of the bionic prosthetic.
Yeah.
Top
yeah.
Gun.
yes, done. I would say, if you say, who are you? I would say, I'm Nigel. I'm an ordinary man with an extraordinary arm. That's how I say it. If you say, are you disabled? Then a little tick goes in the eye. And I would say, no, I'm differently abled. And, you know, I am. I'm differently abled. But then if I really want to provoke you into thinking about what you've just said, I'm quite likely to just say, no, I'm handicapped. And I know that's a bad word in this politically correct world, but I'm an old fart and I'm not politically correct. I would say this is a handicap on the basis that I do everything you do in a world that wasn't designed for me. I do it one-handed. And if I had two hands, you wouldn't keep up with me. Now, that might be total rubbish, but the person that normally gets that in the ear walks away actually thinking probably for the first time in his life what he's just said. So I don't use disability. I don't think anyone has the right to diss your ability. like I say, we do everything that you do with one arm, no arms, one leg missing. James with all sorts of stuff going on over there, you know. And we're just the same as you guys. And to pigeonhole us is just makes life easy for other people. You know, you say, oh, you're disabled. Well, there you go then. And you can categorise us and you throw, oh, you're a worker, and you can throw us away. It just makes life easier for people in the street. It does upset me. Because, I mean, let's face it, how many of you guys can run 100 metres in 11.16 seconds? You know, Johnny Peacock does it every week. He's got one leg. So it's how you look at stuff. I would call myself differently abled.
I feel like we're in a bit of a fortunate position to not... We all probably, I don't know, your personal medical issues, but we don't probably all require 24-hour medical care and attention. We're in a position where we can say, oh, we're not disabled. But yeah, there's people out there that need help.
I do know people that would proudly say, I am disabled.
For sure.
And that certainly means something to them. But the question is, why, for everyone else, why do you need to label it? Like, at the moment, there's a lot of attention in the media about gender identity. And there's this new motion where if you want to be gender neutral, you don't have to be called he or she, you can just be called they. So, you know, if we're doing that for men and women, can we not do that for people with one hand, two hands, you know, whatever it is, because we're all the same ultimately, aren't we? Do we need different labels?
You tease something there around three hands. James, the question that I know often comes up and it'll probably come up in this audience is, you had an opportunity to create whatever arm you wanted. So why something that was anatomically recognizable?
No, that wasn't my goal.
No?
It just ended up being like that. I don't know, it wasn't gonna have a hand originally, and then I had the idea that we could get a cheap one. We couldn't, essentially it wasn't in the project scope to create a functional full arm, because for one thing, I was working with an artist, and then the second thing is that companies that have unlimited resources still haven't created a really good full limb. So it was never really the goal to create something that was really useful and functional. But yeah, so we've just bolted on a 3D printed hand on the end of it because I thought it's a cheap way to get a bit of bionic function, just might as well, whilst I've got this opportunity. But yeah, it was originally just going to be some sort of like mounted module of different technology rather than an arm. I was perfectly happy for it not to be an arm. It just ended up being one. I don't know how. I'm making more arms now, so I'm not attached to this. Like you said, have I got attached to it because I've had this investment in it? I'm attached to it the same way that I could draw a picture and think it was really nice and keep it, but then I draw another picture and I think that one's good too. So yeah, I'm just going to make more, see how they go. I'm all for a tentacle arm.
But, well, we were going to say Japanese porn. But... No glitter cannons, no?
No glitter cannons.
Was that guy?
But when you said there you're not attached to yours, it's kind of strange. When I was testing this, I'm walking my dog. I've got a tiny little dog. I don't need a big dog. I've got a tiny little terrier. And he's run off on one of these extendable leads. Now, my dog only weighs 8 pounds wet. But he's ripped the end of the lead. Every finger broke. You know when you hurt yourself so badly that you feel sick in the pit of your stomach? I felt just like that. I knew it was plastic, I could see it was plastic, but when I saw the fingers just dangling, I actually felt physically sick. So I guess psychologically I must be making...
Is that your wallet hurting though?
No, it was paid for by them, you know, I wasn't paying for it, so... But it was just... And now my phantom hand is what I feel all the time when I open and close this, so maybe I'm making some sort of brain connection with the hand, because I don't do the same movement as Nikki does. You do this to open?
Yeah.
Yeah? I just imagine I'm opening my phantom fingers, and this will open when I've got it in open mode. So this is just me. I'm actually, if you imagine this was a real hand, I'm doing this now, just like I would talk normally. And this just does it. I'm not actually consciously thinking about any movement at all.
Is that a product of the technology inside of it, or is it a product of the duration of spending time?
Duration, yeah, and it's something I noticed around about a year or so ago when I was just reading a book, And I'm lifting my thumb to turn the page. I must have done it 20 or 30 times before I realised that I was just lifting my thumb. And I was actually thinking about lifting my thumb. And that just freaked me out totally because I couldn't understand. When I tried it with this hand, all the movement was down here and I don't have that bit. I couldn't work out where this was coming from. But I understand it now. It's actually from down deep. But this is me, in my brain, I'm moving my thumb. And that's kind of strange, which is why I sort of shy away from the chip in the brain crowd. I'd rather have implants in the nerve endings of my arm. Less invasive. If they go wrong, I might lose a bit of arm. I'd rather lose a bit of arm than the only brain cell I've got.
It's good if you have an arm, Nigel.
Huh?
It's good if you have an arm to put them in.
I accept it. I appreciate that. But for me, I'd rather have...
I'm still scared to put it in my brain.
Yeah, but I wouldn't have... Why have a chip in my brain?
Well, there is that piece. And I know, James, you're running a campaign right now for osseointegration, which is... I mean, firstly, could you explain what osseointegration is to those who may not know? And secondly, why?
Yeah, essentially, it's a technology that came around for trying to get teeth to stay in people's mouths. They drill titanium into your bone, and it kind of anchors. It's a biocompatible material, which means that your bone cells can actually kind of get onto the surface and get in there and make links to it with bone tissue. For me, I literally don't have much arm. I've got about 10 centimeters from the top of my shoulder down of my humerus, which means that when I've got it inside this, I'm moving it around in there, but it doesn't really enact any force. And it just basically means that I can't move this thing around. It's just like a gripper on the end of my arm. So the implants would just bypass the need for something like a socket or a harness. And it would just click on, you click your artificial limb onto it directly. And I think some of them just click on, some need a tiny screw turn, but it just bolts on. So essentially it would extend your skeleton and kind of allows you to load your body in a natural way, whereas this is all over strapped over my shoulders. The weight's just pulling on my skin, I'm sweating into it, my electrodes fall off because of the harness. But just with the implants, it would just be seamless, essentially. It's kind of the way nature intended, but not. Yeah.
Those realities of sweating into the prosthesis, all of this stuff is hidden by all of the folks who come up and go, I want one.
Mm. Yeah. Until you point it out to them.
Until you point it out to them. And are you, or are you?
No, I'd sense, yeah, I do. I mean, like, for example, when I shake hands with people, I do quite often say, you know, I have to pay for the privilege of shaking your hand. And they don't get it until you explain, well, yeah, I charge this up every night. So every time I move it, that's just cost me money for the privilege of being able to lift my thumb. And I explain these, and it's, oh, I didn't think of that. And, you know, once you start having a proper conversation, once all the hypey stuff's gone out of the way and all the excitement's gone, you start to explain, you know, the things it can do and can't do, then it does open people's eyes a little bit. I think a little bit of reality is kind of good every now and again.
So more on that reality in a second, and we're going to open out to the audience. Before we deal with the reality, we're going to deal with a little bit of science fiction. So Stephen Oram is the near future author, near future fiction author in residence with VF, who has kindly written a short story to really explore some of the things that we've been discussing today, and also to give you a little time to think about the question that you might have for our panelists. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Stephen Oram.
Hello. Do I need to test this? No, is that working? So this is, as Luke said, a short story written specially for this evening. It's only about 5 minutes. And this is the first time it's been heard in public. And it might generate some conversation, I think, with us. But anyhow, it's called Loans for Limbs. Christopher's neck was bruised where they'd held him down while forcibly removing his arms and legs. He'd fought them hard, but it had been pointless. Here he was, dumped by the side of the road in an old damp car seat, helpless and homeless. Tears were rolling down his face and he could do nothing about them. How could it have come to this? Less than a year ago, he'd taken an affordable loan from a company that owned massive driverless trucks. He'd replaced his arms and legs with prosthetics to become a highly paid and highly sought after new breed trucker with enough strength to load and unload the huge cargoes. Now look at him, useless, slumped on a dirty seat in the gutter with a small begging bowl the bailiffs had graciously left in front of him. A group of people approached and his hopes rose. As they got close, he called out, "Please, help me." One of the women strolled across and stood over him. "What happened?" "Couldn't keep up the payments," he said. "Will you help?" He jutted his chin towards the bowl. Her husband joined her. "You didn't think about this when you put the rest of us out of work, did you?" "Kenneth, no, it has to be said. I didn't care for his type then, and I most certainly don't care for them now." He spun the seat around with the tip of his foot and left Christopher facing the wall. "Come on, let's get out of here." So, it had come to this. At first it had been great. The wages were high and the loan repayments comparatively low. The envy of former co-workers was sweet, and the job was a doddle. He'd spent days on end sitting in his cab as it drove itself from one end of the country to the other. At random intervals, the truck would require a button to be pressed to prove he was alert, but his right arm was configured to send a small jolt to his brain to prompt him. And his left arm would deliver hits of amphetamine to keep him awake whenever he squeezed his thumb and fourth finger together. It was easy. Then it began. The trucks were constantly upgraded with ever more sophisticated systems that required upgrade after upgrade to his limbs. He'd increased the loan to buy the upgrades, but it hadn't been long before he'd fallen behind with the payments. He stared at the wall, wishing he could punch it. A stray dog with a human skull in its mouth stood nearby, watching. "Good boy," he said, hoping he hadn't betrayed his fear. The dog dropped the skull and snarled. He snarled back, tried to rock himself off the seat but failed and felt a surge of the toxic mix of anger and hopelessness. "Get out of it," shouted a woman from behind him. He tensed, expecting more abuse as a stone hit the ground just in front of the dog. "Hi," she said over his shoulder. "Piss off," he shouted. "We can help. Get lost." She knelt down, dropping a cheap prosthetic leg next to him. "Honestly, we're here to help you. What happened?" "I couldn't keep up the payments, so they repossessed my car, my house, and eventually my limbs. Oh, and then they dumped me here. Satisfied?" "Come with us, we can fit you up with these," she said, tapping the leg. "I told you, I've zero cash, absolutely zero, nothing." Two men lifted the seat with Christopher still in it and strolled towards a white van parked on the other side of the street. "Oi, what do you think you're doing?" he shouted. She talked as she walked alongside. "We're a charity. We rescue the victims of these disgusting corporations. It's what we do." "Yeah, forgive me if I don't believe you." As they lifted him into the back of the van, he recognised the arms and legs on the floor. "Hey, they're mine," he shouted. "Shush," she said, "I know. They're unique, so once repossessed, they have no commercial value. They throw them away, and at night, we sneak in and steal them back." He lifted his head to look her in the eyes. She laughed. "Then we find the owner and reunite them. Neat, eh?" He smiled as she wiped the tears from his face.
So with that, I'd like to open the panel up to audience questions. Unfortunately, we don't have a roaming mic in this room because of the radio interference with the neons. That's a thing, apparently. So you're going to have to shout, but we'd love to take some questions. Please.
Hi, I'm Alex Perlman. I was wondering, since there hasn't been a lot of discussion as much in you feeling like you are enhanced as much as others like Angel, who readily go out there and talk about her prosthetic like it is an enhancement. I was wondering if something else was to befall you, if you were to lose an eye, or if there was an option better than Google Glass for cybernetic upgrades of any kind, would you take them? Would you be interested in that? If the technology was like good enough?
Personally, no, I wouldn't. It's just, this is what I was born with, apart from this thing. You know, I'm quite happy with that.
If I'd lost something, so, you know, you gave the example of an eye, if I suddenly had one eye, then maybe I would look into it.
But I wouldn't remove one.
But as Nigel says, yeah, I know that the technology that I have is not as good as having two hands, so there's no chance I would take out one eye in the hope that it would be better than the other.
You see, the thing is, Angel, really, she is enhanced by her prosthetic because she, you know, she feels enhanced, and rightly so, because she can tie her shoelaces now, whereas she couldn't before because she only had the one arm. So that is, for her, it is an enhancement. And like I said earlier, for me, it wasn't an enhancement because I'd had two arms for 46 years. It's definitely a useful thing to have now because as Nikki was saying, I mean, my left arm is now buggered. It's totally useless. So were it not for something as functional as this, I would be struggling.
Question. If there was technology that existed, like right now, obviously it's not the case, but if in 20 years there was a technology that existed that would give you some sort of enhancement.
But how long would it be better for? You know, it's better in 20 years' time, but then in 40 years' time, I've got 20-year-old technology.
Right.
I feel like in the situation where the technology is going to be good enough, it means that it would have been commercially viable and adopted globally, so I'd be in a better position with more knowledge to understand what would be the best option. Right now, I can't see it because it doesn't exist, so I'd probably just hold fire on saying now whether I would or not and just let people sell it to me. Tell me if it's good enough.
I do see a day when I think somebody will, and I don't think it's too far off, where somebody will, through maybe a minor injury that impedes their speed, perhaps will take a leg off to be able to run fast and become a world champion. Maybe some poor misguided youth who can play football and run really quick down the wing will get his leg taken off because he didn't study at school, and maybe it's the way forward. But I can't see this becoming mainstream, not in my lifetime.
Is that, Nigel, is that a fixed limb? So there's no guarantee of upgrade from bionic. You can't go hand it in and get an upgrade every 2 years, and
I
understand that the technology in the bionic small is completely different from the technology.
Yeah, I believe that they used to at one point, if a hand was damaged or got sent back and there was an upgrade available, they would put the upgrade on that hand. But I think the difference is the fingers on Nikki's hand are different to mine. I mean, mine are open and sort of robotic and stainless steels, and Nikki's a molded, machined alloy. So, you know, this upgrades that Nikki's got, where she's got touchscreen stuff, that will possibly go on to the next version of the medium hand when it comes out, because, you know, there will be a V4. This is the V3. I mean, and that's, again, that could be a problem, because once the V4 comes out, V3 becomes obsolete. There's still 20 million people who've got no access to prosthetics.
Are you able to gift old prosthetics?
I don't know if you are, and there doesn't seem to be any sort of like register whereby you can, if you do decide, or if you do find yourself in a position where you can buy another one, where you could say, well, look, can I trade mine in cash converters and let someone else pick it? I don't think there's a cash converters for prosthetics at the moment, but maybe that would be the way things would go.
There's legs for Africa.
You have legs for Africa. Why not have, you know, legs for Lambeth?
Body shop is already taken.
I think earlier what Nigel made about never seeing the bionic becoming part of the mainstream, it's very intriguing to the three of you talk about these experiences with the NHS and being presented with this hook, and then you've all been very fortunate that you managed the private companies be able to create these, create the prosthetics. Do you have a sense that when you're encountering others, of course we have a captain's position here, where others you encounter who have only really been able to get the bare minimum sort of struggle to understand it and feel, and in that sense, do you feel you're in a position of privilege or in a position of being at the forefront of what is a very bright future for prosthetics?
I think I'm very fortunate because if it weren't for the bionic, I would be wearing a hook. It's as simple as that. So I do feel very fortunate. And as a result, I mean, what I do now is purely, I don't want anyone else to go through what I went through. And if I can say something or do something that's going to maybe change it for one person, that's cool. I'm all right with that. You know, I don't, I sometimes feel guilty, I must admit. I do feel guilty if I see someone with an arm missing when I've got this. You know. But there again, I was made to feel bad when I didn't have an arm. And it was kind of cruel. I mean, I had no right arm, and I'm walking around Tesco's, and I saw a guy with his left arm missing. And I said, walked up and I patted him on the shoulder. I said, mate, do you want to go halves on a pair of gloves? Really, really not a good thing to say. His wife was there and she went mental. I didn't understand at that time what she was going through, because, you know, it's not just you that loses a limb. It's everyone around you that loses that limb as well. And I didn't see that for a while. So me being quite flippant and blasé about stuff actually caused a lot of grief for some people. But I wouldn't ever laud the fact that I've got this and someone's got nothing or a hook or whatever. I did get slapped down for saying to someone that, you know, everyone should get exosuits so they could stand on their own 2 feet. I thought that was kind of a nice thing to say. But I got slapped down viciously by a wheelchair user who said, what gives you the right to tell me to get up and walk? And that's what it's about. It's about choice. And it's about having the choice and being allowed to have the choice to choose what you feel would give you the best quality of life. And it shouldn't be dependent on some expert with two arms and two legs who's never met you. And that's unfortunately as it is in the NHS. You know, it's budget-led by experts who sit wherever they sit with their two arms and two legs. You know? I think it would be kind of nice if they were to picture the look on their child's face when they went home and said, sorry, sweetheart, for the rest of your life you've got to wear a badly fitting brown hobnail boot. If they could picture the image on their child's face, perhaps they wouldn't be so keen on giving hooks out to people. But they don't have the empathy.
That was an interesting scenario when I was in Texas with this at Body Hacking Con. And Angel and I went without my arm because it was really heavy. At that time, I was getting used to it. And we were walking around. She was in like a sleeveless top or something. And she had her hand. She was just gesturing, just being natural. And we were walking through an area of where
6th Street, Austin. Yeah. If you've ever been there, bionic prosthetics weren't the weirdest thing on that.
But when you go a few blocks further north, it was just completely filled with homeless people. And it was a really strange thing. People were just like staring at her, like wild animals, like just following us around car parks, because they were just like, what the hell is this? Like, they just don't understand what it was. And it gave us this weird sense of being, I was just looking at her like, this is very strange. You're like a technological elite. These people can't even eat or find shelter. And we're just walking through going choo, 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 with our robot hands. And it was such a strange feeling. And it just had, there's so much other stuff that we need to focus on. But it's the weird position that we have whereby we're the ones that are starting this kind of field off. It's like, how many bionic users are there? Like 300, you said? It's nothing. But it's still just, it's a really strange position to be put in. Really weird. And with the access of these things to people in need who maybe want something better than a hook, there's definitely a lot of interesting changes, like with 3D printed prosthetics. Because essentially what's been happening is that there's companies out there making really great commercial hands, but they're just so expensive, they only have 300 people to sell it to. And what the 3D printed people are doing, the open bionics, for example, they're testing new designs at the moment. This is a prototype, and I've broken the thumb because it's not that strong. But what we're doing, what they're doing, is creating things that have like the multi-articulation that you have. You can control, you can set the fingers into their own positions, and you can control it pretty much in exactly the same way. The only thing is the construction and the strength, essentially. And what that's going to do is just really mess up the landscape for the commercial companies. They're going to have products that cost 500 quid to 2,000 pounds competing in their arena of 12,000 pounds per unit. So they're going to be in a bit of trouble, I think. They're going to be wondering, how can we deal with this? And either it's just going to be better for people because they'll be able to hopefully invest in something that costs the price of a laptop rather than the price of a car, even if the NHS can't do it. I'm trying to work with people in 3D design companies to create a workflow where you can scan limbs and develop the technology and the process so that even people that are kind of a lay person could find someone in a hack space or make a whatever zone and get some help in creating their own artificial limbs if they so desired for this reduced cost. So I feel like, yeah, we're definitely still at the start of something.
But even in that space, there's massive miscommunication around the possibilities of 3D printing, because there's a lot of advocates of 3D printing versus the reality of when you put plastic onto the body. And I know Jeff Ehrenstone, who we were blessed to share a stage with at 3D Print Show, points to that directly, going, look, 3D printed plastics aren't as good as bionic materials that are being used.
No matter what you want to say about how
this is going to make them available to everybody.
I think what you'll get is you'll get a collaboration between the big corporations and open bionics type people to ensure that their hand's bigger, because what they will eventually understand is that if you use a 3D printed hand that you're going to break all the time, it's a learning process until you get used to not breaking it before you upgrade to one of their super duper special ones. And I think that's how they'll filter it down. Much like Marlboro cigarettes now make e-liquids, you know? They can't get you on the fags, they get you on the e-fags. It'll be that sort of thing. If they can't sell their unit because it's 15, 25, 35, 65,000 pounds, they'll have another little company off the side and they'll get together with 3D printing people and they'll make something much cheaper that you can break and replace every 3 or 4 years.
Open Bionics recently got a request of a large purchase order of their hands by a major company, which I probably won't name because it's probably not professional to, I guess. But, so there's interest, there's exactly that happening potentially.
That's the way forward.
Well, it was that self-making or the maker movement, which is the reason I reached out to you, Catherine, because you're a practicing artist. You work in the BioFutures lab, and the discussion we had, the interest was almost coming from the process of creation, because you haven't lost anything, there's really nothing to gain, arguably.
Yeah.
At least that's what you were telling me. And that process of that ability to make a piece of artwork or a creative process in which it figures your body, I just wonder if that is a bigger drive than this possibility of functionality.
I guess in some respects, yeah, because I've had an interest in this area anyway. So for me, it's kind of like the two worlds now are overlapping, and that's very exciting for me. And I think I'm very interested in a lot of the kind of ethical issues that you were talking about that I haven't even considered, really. I suppose in my mind, it's quite a utopian image, but yeah, there are definitely things that we need to think about, but this is such a new area of technology, and it's only natural that all of these issues are going to happen, and it's only by kind of furthering these technologies and pushing these areas that we'll really figure out what's right and what's wrong and kind of the right way to go. But I feel that it's not something that we should, all of this kind of far future cyborg kind of hacking off limbs, and it's so far away in my mind. And even to have the technology to be even as good as a human hand, let alone better, I don't even think that could happen within my lifetime. So it's not that we shouldn't worry about that, but it's that we shouldn't let that halt the development of these things.
Is there a need almost to manage expectations of the present so that we don't get disappointed or let down in the future, perhaps?
Yeah, I guess so. But then also, there's no reason to not speculate and to not imagine the kinds of futures that we do want, because ultimately, we're not going to know what we want unless we do make a few mistakes. And like, those mistakes are already happening, you know, they're not working, they're uncomfortable, they're heavy, they break. But that's all part of the development, and it really, really is very early stages with all of this. It's, I mean,
So we have probably time for one more question. Oh, this is really hard. Two more questions. Catherine.
Christine, I have a question for the two bionics users. Are you at all worried about maintenance? Like, what would happen if the bionic goes bust? And you know, the components you have cannot be maintained anymore, and what would happen?
Okay, well, for me, this hand actually belongs to bionic. It's not mine. It's still the test hand. This was the hand I started testing in 2011. It's had several fingers and several other bits and bobs added to it, but it's basically the same hand that I had. And if bionic went bust and they wanted it back, then they'd have to get it back. It was simple as that.
Do you have the rest of the system that's connected?
Oh, I mean, I've got a hook at home. I'll just plug a hook in.
Okay.
You know, I won't be happy about it.
But
no, I mean, it's something that I don't think I'd never even thought about it, to be honest. What if they go bust? It never occurred to me. You know. And if it did go bust and it was to stop working, well, then it would sit on the mantelpiece looking good.
For me, I obviously only got this quite recently, so I think I still have a healthy percentage of time where I don't wear it. So if I had to give it back, then I would be okay without it. My life would be a bit different, but I would get by. And I guess I am reserving that ability in myself so that I know I can get by without it, because again, this belongs to bionic. It belongs to SEPA, it's not mine. If I had to give it back, then I would. And I don't think they'll ask for it back tomorrow, but if something happened like they went bust, then maybe I would have to give it back.
There's a problem with mine is this. I own this. my thumb's broken and I need two hands to fix it, so. Sucks. Still need other help, so.
And perhaps time for two more questions. Vicky and this gentleman here. After you.
You've spoken a lot about the technological limitations of the prosthetics when you're talking about this idea of prosthetic envy. But what about the ethical issues? If in the future your prosthetics were significantly better functionally than my hand, should I be able to choose to have one of yours instead?
Why not? Why not? Why not? What gives me the right to have something like that and deny you it? That's just not fair. You want to go for it, go for it. If there's something there that's better, go for it. If that's what you want, it's your choice. But like I say, you should have a choice.
Whether a health service provides it is another story. And additionally, there's the issue that when we can debate ethics to do with artificial limbs and bionics, and it kind of, you get the technological elite situation coming through. It kind of makes you think that we need to be addressing the whole world's problems. When essentially, it's still, we need to think about our stuff and we need to develop our things. It's not like, I mean, it's like a prosthetic arm costs a lot and you can give them to people and you could pay for it. And then there's other issues in taxation and in whatever parts of in an industry that could solve other problems that aren't related to bionic arms, you know? Do you know what I mean? No? No, it's just like we're debating about limbs in the same way that feminists are debating about women's issues. They're not trying to create universal equality. They're focusing on their own thing. So it's like we're focusing on the ethics of limbs. We don't want to talk about whether everybody should have everybody upgraded in the whole world, you know?
But you're talking about it because it's part of your identity, at least now, is it not?
what is? What, this? I don't know, not really yet.
It's your gift and curse.
I mean, when I take it off, I kind of feel like something's missing sometimes. But Nigel, my phantom limb has not moved down to the hand yet. And it's kind of telescoped up here because the hand has the most inputs from the brain, so it kind of, the rest of it disappears in your brain's mental image of your body. But I'm imagining the point when I get that cool connection going through, that would be pretty significant for me.
And then one last question, which I think was this gentleman here.
Yeah, so I was really interested about this element of like the hand becoming symbiotic in the sense that when the fingers came off, that felt pain. So when you return to something that you were disabled from doing for a while or not able to do for a while, like reading, what was it like when you came to something you weren't able to do before you'd even lost your limb, like the 350 wrist thing? How did those two feelings compare, the 360?
Well, see, the 360 is really just an equalizer. I do that to show off because I know that whenever people go home, they'll say, look, I saw this baldy-headed old bloke the other day and he can spin his wrist round. I know they'll say that. And then the conversation will start, how, why, what, where, when. And it will start a conversation. They'll never go home and say, I met an amputee who can't feel his wife's hand. That's why I spin the wrist round. It's not necessary. I mean, I find it helpful if I'm opening a cupboard. I open the cupboard, I want to pick something up down there. I can't do this. So it's just as easy for me to just spin my wrist round, open the cupboard, grab what I want to grab, and then carry on.
So you kind of see your hand with the, you see your robotic hand being able to do something that you were never able to do with your hand before?
No, strangely enough, no. When I do that, it's an attachment that's doing it, it's a bit of machinery. When I'm opening my fingers, it feels like my fingers. But because my wrist doesn't go that far, that doesn't feel real. So it still feels like a mechanical thing that I'm making it do.
That just must be the kind of staunch imprinting of getting to 46.
Yeah, I mean, eventually, maybe I will if I think about it for long enough.
Like if you give it to a child from birth.
Yeah, they would think that it's quite normal to rotate your wrist. Yeah, I'll think about it a bit more and see what it's like in a year or so. Yeah, it is interesting. I tried to see if I could feel things just by touching them. There's no sense of feeling on this, but I have tried on a lot of occasions to pick up grapes and things like this and try and convince myself that, I mean, this, if I feel something down there, it's normally the middle finger, but it's trying to work out where all the others are. It's not going to be successful, I'm sure, but I still try. You know,
considering...
Yeah, not so much the pain, it was more the sickness mechanism. Yeah, I didn't feel it. It was just the sickness that came with it. And that must be a psychological as opposed to a physical thing.
And considering, Nikki, there is no phantom, is it a very different relationship?
So I haven't found anything that my hand can do that my left hand can't, except for the silly things that I was never able to do. I never even thought I'd want to do, like, I don't know, I can just about do the old heart sign now. And when I first did that, that meant more to me than being able to tie my shoelaces with two hands, because I could do my shoelaces with one hand.
What about scratching your left elbow? That is just awesome, to be able to scratch. Oh, and that. Oh! You know, my stump just doesn't reach, you know? Yeah. There's things like that, they're kind of nice.
You're making me want my implants now, because I can't do it. I'm always itchy on the scars.
My favourite thing is shaking hands with people. Yeah. That is just brilliant because I get to see people smile.
But also it takes away that awkward reaction where before I'd go, oh, left hand, what am I doing? This, don't kiss my hand, that's weird.
You did that to me though.
I know. Well, that's because we had a whole new situation going on.
So before the panellists get prosthetic envy over each other's prosthetic devices, and I saw it on Twitter as soon as this kicked off. You, Angel, you guys were at each other. It was like, yeah, mine's got longer battery life, and mine lights up. And so that's Angel all over Americans. So let the, as Bernard Wolf would say, let the limbo have the final word. You are enhanced so long as you think you're enhanced. We all have limb difference, so embrace that little mole on your left hand. And let me end with this. The future is always virtual, and some things that may seem inevitable never actually happen. Fortunately, our ability to survive the future is not predicated on our capacity for prediction. Though, on those much more rare occasions, something remarkable comes of staring the future deep in the eyes and challenging everything that it seems to promise. I hope you feel you've done that tonight. Please join me in thanking these fantastic panelists, James, Nikki, Catherine, and Nigel. The bar is now open.